everybody. I'm honored to chair this evening panel of this promising meeting about migration to Latin America. I'm Ofra Gold-Sanghidoni from Tel Aviv University, working on Japan. We are going to have three presentations. Each will last about 20 minutes. And we will hopefully have time for Q&A and discussion for the last 30 minutes or so. So let's start. I'm happy to present the first speakers, Professor Ra'anan Rein and Dr. Aya Udagawa. Professor Rein, Ivrit, is the Elias Saraski Professor of Latin American and Spanish History and Vice President of this university, Tel Aviv University, and the head of the Daniel Abraham Center for International and Regional Studies. And is the author and editor of more than 30 books, as well as over 100 articles in academic journals and book chapters in several languages. Now, if I start counting the honorable awards that you received, you will not have time for the presentation, so please look at your handouts. And Professor Rein will present with Dr. Aya Udagawa, or according to the new request from the Japanese government, using the Japanese way of naming Udagawa, Aya. Dr. Udagawa is research fellow of Tel Aviv University and of the Japan Society for the Promotion of Science. She received a PhD from Tokyo University on the topic of Jewish community in Buenos Aires. She currently starts a new research project, Anthropology of Archives in Israel. And the title of their talk is Los Muchachos Peronistas Japones, the Peronist Movement and the Nikkeis, the last part I know.
Thank you, Ofra. So, in late November 1953, a large number of Japanese Argentines gathered at the main hall of the Asociación Japonesa Argentina in order to cheer President Juan Domingo Perón. In his speech, Perón emphasized the important contribution of Japanese immigrants to the development of Argentina, and the sympathy and respect shown by most Argentines towards the small community of these Asian immigrants. And I quote, "Nosotros no hacemos entre los hombres otro distingo ni otra discriminación que en hombres buenos y en hombres malos. La comunidad japonesa en la Argentina es una comunidad que ha demostrado a lo largo de muchos años que está formada por hombres buenos, respetuosos de la ley y amantes de este país," end of quote. At the same time, the Argentine president highlighted the diasporic relations between the local Japanese community and its recently devastated homeland at the end of World War II, and I quote again, "Nos sentimos dichosos y felices de que después de terminada la Segunda Guerra Mundial, la República Argentina haya sido el primer país del mundo donde se cantó el himno japonés por primera vez. Y nos sentimos felices de que la flota mercante de la Nueva Argentina haya sido también la primera línea de navegación de ultramar que ha unido los pueblos del Japón y de Argentina." End of quote. Accompanied by the mayor of Buenos Aires, Jorge Sabaté, and the Supreme Court President, Rodolfo Guillermo Valenzuela, Perón went on and on to say that both Argentines and Japanese are attached to a large extent because of their common spiritual values, and therefore the social integration of Japanese immigrants and their descendants born in Argentina should face no obstacle. The other two speakers in this event were the Japanese ambassador to Argentina, Toshitaka Okubo, I hope I pronounced the name correctly, and the president of this ethnic association, Kagashi Sugawara. Sugawara expressed his gratitude to the president for emphasizing time and again that he wanted the Japanese living in Argentina to feel como si estuvieran en su propio país. The association, which had briefly had to stop its activities during the Second World War, was permitted by the Argentine government to restart this ethnic enterprise as a sociedad de beneficencia and as a representative body of the Japanese community in Argentina. the Eva Peron Foundation received its own praise for sending help to the afectados por las inundaciones que allí se produjeron últimamente. Indeed, in March 1949, the foundation sent 44 tons of food items and 7,000 tons of clothes to Japan. Interestingly enough, when the ship entered the Yokohama port, the captain lifted the Japanese flag. As Japan was still under US occupation, the American army ordered the captain to remove the flag, but he refused. Upon returning to Buenos Aires, the captain was awarded a prize by Perón. Now, this event, with the various speeches, was widely covered by the Argentine press, and I think that it highlights the new policy and the new discourse adopted by the Peronist government towards various immigrant groups, especially non-European and or non-Christian immigrant groups, such as Jews, Arabs, and Asians. So after briefly discussing Japanese immigration to Argentina since the beginning of the 20th century, this paper focuses on the relations between the Peronist government and the local Japanese community, as well as the mobilization of at least a part of these communities to support the Peronist doctrine and the presidential couple. Although much smaller than the Jewish or Arab community in Argentina, the number of the so-called Nippo Argentinos, or Nikkei, by the end of World War II was estimated at some 10,000, not more than that. Still, the study offers us an additional lens to analyze the policies and public discourse of the Peronist government towards ethnic minorities in Argentina. Aya.
So I will just go back historically, and I will talk about the small historical background of Nikkei society. And Nikkei literally means people of Japanese origin, which refers to Japanese immigrants and their descendants abroad, like Brazil, Hawaii, United States, and Argentina. The population of Nikkei in Argentina at the present is estimated 30,000, though official census does not exist. The majority of them lives around Gran Buenos Aires. In 1886, the assumed first Japanese immigrant, Kinzo Makino, settled in Argentina. Until 1895, only 10 Japanese people were settled there. In 1898, the Treaty of Friendship, Commerce, and Navigation was signed between Argentina and Japan. There are two major characteristics of Argentine Nikkei society in comparison with other immigrants in Latin America. First of all, the immigrants of first generation arrived independently. They were not in the bilateral contract with the host country, which was the case of Brazil. In Brazil, they emigrated through the agency and worked as contracted farmers, as you see there. This is a very famous image of the advertisement of immigration agency, and they worked as farmers like in coffee plantations and farmland. But in Argentina, in contrast, most of the Japanese immigrants arrived by themselves and brought their family members afterwards. In other cases, they relocated from Brazil or Peru to Argentina. The second characteristic is that 70 to 80% of the immigrants were from Okinawa, the far southwestern islands, here in Japan. Okinawa was once independent kingdom, and there is a cultural difference with mainland Japan. The immigration was mainly enforced by their economic situation. Radical modernization in Japan contributed to the development of some of the country in the cost of other parts, especially those of the rural areas. From the first wave of immigrants until 1920s, the Japanese community got to form a stronger network. However, this does not mean any kind of geographical segregation. They organized associations based on the original prefectures or villages. Between those associations, the foundation of the Asociación Japonesa en la Argentina in 1916 was a notable occasion. These images are the founding members of AJA and the main office of AJA, which was located on Patagones. This organization, AJA, collaborated with Japanese embassy to realize consular transactions, registers, and travel documents. Also, AJA realized the foundation of schools for the children born in Argentina. Thus, the first generation of immigrants kept direct connection with the Japanese government through the embassy. Those days, many immigrants used to work in cafeteria or as taxi drivers. But later on, clothes cleaning shops and florists became typical jobs, which still continue to be the stereotypical image of Japanese workers in Argentina. As you see on this picture of tinteria, a famous tinteria of Japanese, those who had success in the business employed also the Japanese employees and managed the larger shop. The Japanese community in Argentina before 1940s was not the biggest in Latin America. These are the numbers. The community in Argentina was after Brazil, Peru and Mexico until the mid of 20th century. So afterwards, the relationship between Japanese immigrants and their homeland Japan changed radically during and after the Second World War. The majority of the immigrants who had arrived in Argentina before the war thought of just gaining money and getting home soon. This is evidenced by their very low rate of naturalization, generally less than 10% before 1940s. However, after the end of the war, Japan lost the war, the majority abandoned their dreams of getting back home. So most of the Japanese families preferred to educate their children as Argentine nationals. Many of them abandoned to educate their children or speak in Japanese language and rather focused on the Spanish education and Spanish language. Immigration toward Argentina was forbidden during the war. However, after 1950s, a Japanese government saw immigrant policy as a solution for the population problems. In 1950, when official immigration toward Argentina started again, this was even before the Treaty of Peace with Japan, and also before the end of the American-led Allied occupation of Japan in 1952. Between 1952 until 1993, immigration had continued constantly. The total number of influx during this period was 2,760. So, at the last part of my words, I will shortly introduce two of the main Japanese ethnic newspapers. One is La Plata Hochi, reports from La Plata. This is founded in 1947, originally as a community newspaper of an Okinawan community. This was more populistic in the character than the other ethnic newspaper, Akoku Nippo. Akoku Nippo, a daily news from Argentina, is said to be targeted more to the educated audience. However, the number of Japanese readers who can read in Japanese, these publications began to decline after 1960s. Akoku Nippo stopped its function in 1980s, And at the present, La Plata Hochi is the only Japanese ethnic newspaper in Argentina.
Although it certainly had several authoritarian characteristics, Peronism also advanced democratization in a situation of social, ethnic, and economic inequality. The efforts to include previously excluded groups went beyond the working class and targeted also women, children, indigenous peoples, and immigrant groups, such as Japanese. Most studies have focused on the principal beneficiaries newly integrated into the national polity, that is the working class. And our own research highlights that immigrant groups, including Jews, Arabs, and Japanese, also made important gains. I wouldn't go into this, but the number of Arab Argentine Congress deputies increased dramatically, and as to Jews, one of the important steps was the creation of a Jewish section of the Peronist Party. Ethnic identities became less of a threat to the concept of Argentinidad. Instead of the traditional melting pot, Perón's government supported hyphenated identities and emphasized the wide variety of cultural sources on which Argentine society was based. Authorities offered unprecedented recognition of cultural and ethnic differences. Now, Perón's original vision of Argentina as essentially a Catholic country was clearly manifested while he was a key figure in the military dictatorship of 1943 to 1945 during the election campaign of late 1945 and early 1946, as well as in the initial stages of his presidency. The alliance between Sword and Cross seemed solidified, and when they first came to power, Peronists considered non-Catholics as not good Argentines, quote unquote. The government transformed into law the December 1943 military decree instituting compulsory Catholic education in all state schools. And on one occasion, Perón declared, and I quote, "I think that in our country it is impossible to speak of an Argentine home that is not a Christian home. Under the cross, we formed our ideas. Under the cross, we recited our ABCs. Everything distinctive in our habits is Christian and Catholic." According to Perón, in the early 1940s, national belonging excluded non-Catholics. Early Peronist immigration policies also reflected an ethnic concern and an endeavor to assure as much as possible ethnic and cultural homogeneity in the country's population. And indeed, in the early years of Peronism, both Jews and Arabs had to confront various obstacles on their immigration to Argentina. When it comes to Japanese Argentines, following an initiative by Father Virgilio Filippo, a popular priest designated adjunto ecclesiastico alla Presidencia de la Nación and elected to the National Congress in 1948, the government started a campaign to convert Japanese Argentines into Catholicism, supposedly in order to facilitate their integration into Argentine society. With the blessing of Eva Perón, Filippo, a diehard anti-communist, anti-Masonic, and anti-Semitic, organized in 1948 several ceremonies of group baptism of Nike. These events were held at Filippo's Inmaculada Concepcion Church in the Buenos Aires neighborhood of Belgrano. One of them, which included a collective baptism of more than 100 Japanese immigrants, was directed by Teizo Okawa and attended by the Chief of Federal Police, General Arturo Bertolo, as well as officials of the national government. 1948 also witnessed the establishment of the Centro Católico, whose honorary president was Eva Perón. The largest baptism event included the conversion of no less than 856 people. Thus, the total number of Japanese converted to Catholicism was more than 1,000, more or less some 10% of the community. However, if most scholars tend to look at Peronism as a static political movement, what we try to point to is the transformation of policies and public discourse as to different ethnic communities, including Japanese Argentines. In the early 50s, we see a different kind of public discourse emphasizing the inclusive approach of Peonism, showing respect to all religions, and this became to define a feature of Peonism. One of the most important Japanese Argentines who reached a prominent position in Peonist Argentina was Angel Kiyoshi Gashu. I won't be able to mention anything about his career, and his brother became an economic secretary in the Argentine embassy in Tokyo. I'm afraid of Ofra. So let me move into the conclusions. In his speech quoted earlier, the president of the Asociación Japonesa in La Argentina, Sukawara, glorified the Peronist enterprise and mentioned the 10,000 Japanese Argentine soldiers in the Peronist army, as he called it. Peron's new policies toward various ethnic groups, effectively treating them like corporate units within his vision of the comunidad organizada, was practiced with the Japanese-Argentine community as well. At the symbolic level, it was certainly important, and it also helped in strengthening the ties between Argentina and Japan. At the same time, in the short term, it gave very few political dividends to the president and his ruling party, as we just heard from Aya, despite the liberalization of Argentine citizenship requirements by the Perón regime. It seems that less than 10% of Japanese and Okinawans opted for an Argentine citizenship at that time, and therefore most of them were not eligible for voting or for holding a post. So, while the Jewish section of the Peronist Party, the Organización Israelita Argentina, was established already in 1947, it took more time to form a separate section for Japanese Argentines. But in May 1955, the Sección Japonesa del Partido Peronista was launched. As the regime did not survive for long afterwards, this section did not make an impact within and without the local community. Thank you very much.